The Colorado Avalanche get back into the win column, and in the process, prevent the Wild from getting their first win of the season. They didn't get seven goals. I wanted those seven goals, but they got six. I'm okay with that. We just missed the extra point. That's fine. So much to talk about with this game. Some parts good, some parts sloppy. You had good offensive play. You had good defensive play. You had great goaltending. Did Alexander Georgiev win me over? He's going down that path if he makes some plays like he did tonight. A lot to get to with this one. Avalanche and Minnesota Wild. Let's get to it.
Your Locked On Avalanche, your daily podcast on the Colorado Avalanche. Part of the Locked On Podcast Network, your team every day.
If this was not an early season hockey game, I don't know what was. But the Avalanche do pull this thing out 6-3 against the Minnesota Wild and get back into the win column. Now 2-1-0 on the season. And thank you for making this your first listen of the day over here at Locked On Avalanche, part of the Locked On Podcast Network, your team every day. You can follow us on our social media outlets, LOPN_Avalanche on Twitter, Locked On Avalanche on Instagram. Questions, comments, concerns, opinions, LockedOnAvalanche@gmail.com. And follow us on our YouTube channel over on YouTube. Hit subscribe, get notified when a new show goes live. All right, sir. Yeah, this was just it was a fun game. I thought it was an entertaining game. It wasn't the most smoothest game, like on the eyes to watch, but at points it was. And I thought there were, you know, the individual performances were you can pull out of here. But you could tell this was just like an early season matchup where things just were not like buttoned up and a couple of things, you know, there's a little bit sloppiness here and there. But then you get like some really nice plays and some good offensive possessions and good defensive stops and things like that. So kind of just a complete mashup of a hockey game with the good and the bad.
Yeah, you're starting to see how this team's starting to evolve, and it's starting to molt and shed some of that old skin. Like you could definitely see some room for improvement. I mean, you could do that all year long, even in game 82 and how they play in the Stanley Cup. I mean, there's always room for improvement, but yeah, it's the early part of the season. You could see some things that need to be tightened up, especially the penalty kill, still a little suspect. But with all that penalty kill ugliness, the goalie position starting to look a lot better.
Well, I mean, and you know, this is still work in progress for me. We're obviously still early in the season, but yeah, I mean, I thought I do like his play. Yeah. The more, you know, it's only a couple games and in the preseason, but I just like how he positions himself and the one that like, man, if he's going to make a series of saves like he did on that really bad Eric Johnson turnover that just gave Minnesota a 2-on-1, maybe even a 3-on-1, he made just save after save. I think Minnesota got like good shots on him. And not only did he just like, you know, the first one, I think it was a wild play, but I think it rebounded off of him. And then he just gets up and puts himself in a really good position.
Yeah.
So you can see like that the talent and the skill that he has in playing the position because he's quick. You know, everybody plays the butterfly now, so he does that. But how quick he gets back into the position is really what's impressive to me. And if shots were getting past him, and even he's still not getting in good position, I'd be like, okay, it's just, you know, he'll just get into the flow of games and you know, the saves will start coming, but he's doing that now. And I believe, if I'm not mistaken, the two games he's played, the only goals he's let in are from power play goals. I don't think he's given up an even strength goal yet, if I'm not mistaken.
That sounds about right. I'm gonna have to look.
I mean, the way the power play's been.
True. And you know, you're mentioning like Georgiev putting himself in the right position. It's like he's snapping himself into that position. Like it's like fundamentally correct. Like he's plopping himself down. Like it's like snap, snap, snap. And even that that terrible turnover on the power play that almost turned into a shorthanded goal, that Hartman, he just missed the net completely, almost had a goal. He was still in the right positioning. It's just Hartman had 200 feet to play with, and Georgiev only has that, 5-10 feet in that painted area to play with. Like, he just got outmaneuvered, but he's still in the right position. So I don't know if this is because we had Darcy Kuemper and Grubauer and so many goalies that played all over the ice, and even Frankie, he's known to swim on the frozen lake out there. Just a goalie that knows the right positioning is just so refreshing now. Definitely winning me over, being a very vocal Frankie fan.
So in game one against Chicago, the two goals were power play goals by Chicago. In this one, two out of the three were power play goals. And the Kaprizov goal was even strength. That was the first one that was not a power play goal. So, you know, and I'm not saying he's part of the problem on the power play. I think the whole power or on the penalty kill, I should say. That is definitely a problem for the Avalanche right now. And this is where things kind of like went their way. There was they were going to be a power play for the Wild, and in the process, they decided to have too many men on the ice. It was a 4-on-4, and then the Avs were given a penalty, but the play was continuing. And to get the extra man out, they just had a brain fart on the bench for the Wild. I get it, you know, in the heat of the moment, but they an extra skater went out, and instead of having five because it was a 4-on-4, they had six. So that negated the Avalanche penalty, and I breathed a sigh of relief.
Yeah,
because you don't have confidence right now in the Avalanche penalty kill, and that's really the one thing that you can look at. I know we're only three games into the season, and the second game was a back-to-back, which wasn't horrific, but the way that they played against Calgary wasn't the best, obviously. But right now, you're if there's anything that's like bad, you kind of take it with a grain of salt because it's so early in the season. But the one thing that you can't, just like Minnesota and their goaltending right now, how you're like, that's concerning for the Avalanche, it's the penalty kill.
Yeah, like last year, I think it was every other game we were complaining about the faceoffs. Like, it was a problem, a huge
it's
problem.
It's still bad.
It's bad, but better. There is some improvement. Like, it was pretty close to even-ish tonight or last night.
What was it? 45-55 in favor of the Wild.
Which is, we can live with that. That's good. I mean, it's a lot better. And they're winning the faceoffs when they need to. So you're seeing a lot more improvement there. It looks like this year we're going to have to do something with the penalty kill. And it's not one of those, as soon as Landeskog or Helm come back, this will be fixed. No, they're not really known for what they're doing on the penalty kill. So there has to be some kind of adjustment schematically, because something's not working on the penalty kill. And right now it's enough to get by, but this is not sustainable.
Definitely not. And it's sure maybe some of it is just, you know, early season dust. But you don't want to just rely on that. You just don't want to say like, oh, it'll work itself out. Maybe to a small percentage it might. But you're right. I think just something needs to change there. And I don't know. I think it'll get better. It will get better because it's such a difference between their power play, which is like number one in the league, but take that for what it's worth after a couple games, and their penalty kill, which I haven't looked it up, but I'm willing to bet is 32nd. So you don't want that, because when you have guys like Curtis McDermott taking a really dumb penalty, you know what I mean? Like it was just, and at a key point in the game too.
Yeah.
You can't keep cross-checking the guy in the back. Like, you can do it once, and if he doesn't fall down, you got away with it. That doesn't mean go do it again. And he kept doing it. And those are the things that I just don't like from him. And it wasn't necessary. Like, the puck was up against the boards. Fight for the puck.
Yeah.
Don't fight the man. And you're not even involved in the play. He was behind the play. I don't know who was involved for the Avalanche, but it was him and two other guys. And McDermott just starts whacking away at the guy in his back. That's just, he's right in front of you. His numbers are right in front of you. They're going to call that.
And yeah, I think it's Cogliano in there.
Might have been. Was it? It could have been. Who knows? But you just got to be smarter than that. You have to be.
And the reason we're pointing this out, it's not like we beat the Wild, whoop-de-doo, let's pick the team apart. Like, if you look at this team's roster and how it's comprised, this team should night in, night out, be the example on how you comprise a team and win games. And when you see like things like the penalty kill that are so glaring as a problem, this is something that needs to be adjusted. You're not just drinking the Kool-Aid out of the Stanley Cup and saying, oh, we could beat anybody. No, this is something we have to work on. And another thing that's really starting to get me a little bit, I really saw it jumping out off the screen in the third period, our positioning. There is a lot of sticks just flailing about that on a bad night with a bad ref, the penalties will start racking up and that penalty kill is going to have to be out there even more. So if you get that positioning right where you're not just swiping at everything that's out there, you have to get your positioning right. I understand you're fatigued, but the more the season goes on, the tighter those calls get. And that's something that also needs to be cleaned up.
Broncos lost in overtime, by the way.
So, I saw that.
Yeah. All right, let's hear from Built Bar, and then we'll kind of get into specifics and guys that we thought had good games. Obviously, we have a sound check to get to and our top players of the game. But first, Built Bar, we talk about it all the time. You know it, you love it. Right now, Built.com has it's a giveaway. It's a free Halloween bag with any purchase over $65. It's not like you have to buy one specific flavor or anything like that, or one specific type of Built Bar. If your order adds up to $65, they will send you this really neat little free Halloween bag. Who doesn't? I mean, I'm still going trick or treating. My kids are going to do the trick or treating for me. Is how it works when you get to be my age. Yeah.
And with that Built Bar bag, I can spread the good news.
Load it up.
Built Bar door to door.
They also have a brand new puff flavor. It's the pumpkin pie puff. I mean, Kyle's in all his heaven right now. That actually comes with white chocolate instead of the typical dark chocolate. So they have that for the holiday season. They also have a toffee almond flavor. And there was one other one that you threw out when we were talking
about. There's a pina colada puff.
There is a pina colada. So if you want the summer to hang around a little bit longer, go get the pina colada puff. Why not?
You just named off three flavors. There's your $65 order and your holiday bag, your Halloween bag. Boom. You're welcome.
Done. So go to Built.com right now. Most Built Bars and Built Bar puffs contain only 160 calories and 15 grams of protein. It's all the good stuff that you need. Go to Built.com. Use that promo code LOCKEDON15, and you'll get 15% off of your order. Once again, the promo code is LOCKEDON15 for 15% off at Built.com. All right, let's get into some of the stats and player specifics. We'll start with the scoring, and it was opened up by Ben Myers with a really nice tip-in goal.
Yeah.
I don't want to say it was reviewed, but I think some Wild players were throwing their hands up in the air, and it was pretty close that it was a high sticking, but it was one of those. It's like, no, we're not really going to overturn that. So when you saw the first couple of replays, you were pretty confident it was going to be upheld, and it was. So he had the first goal of the game, and then followed up pretty quickly by Kirill Kaprizov, and he's one of those guys, man, that it's like you can't talk enough about how good he is. He's honestly like one of those guys when he is out on the ice, like you hope you can just get through the shift and he doesn't do a lot of damage to you. He's scary good, and like I said, he's just one of those guys that you can we have him on our team. Cam McCarr, Nathan McKinnon. There's, you know, the other teams in the league and the other podcast hosts at Locked On NHL are probably, whenever they go up against the Avalanche, talking and just waxing poetic about McCarr and Rantanen and McKinnon. And that's us with Kirill Kaprizov.
Yep.
Guy is so good, and he's fun to watch.
Yeah, it's that same caliber of player. Like, Sidney Crosby, Ovechkin, McDavid. Like that one player that you can, that everybody talks about. If you have no passing knowledge of the rest of the roster, you know them and the team is built around them. And that's the same with Kirill the Thrill. He is incredible, though he's wearing the worst sweater on earth. I mean, he's somebody you have to respect, and he's only going to get better. So you're enjoying the fact that you did get to hang six on the Wild, even though Kirill got two.
Yeah, he's just insanely good. And I'm not breaking any news there, but he's awesome. Sammy G gets on the board with a nice goal from him. And then, you know, kind of going down the line, you had Joel Eriksson Ek, Mikko Rantanen, and then Josh Manson with a really nifty goal. It was kind of like Jack Johnson-esque. Not that it was a breakaway or anything like that, but he kind of like weaved his way. He was down more towards like the goal line extended, and just made a pretty move to center or to slot, I should say, and a sweet backhand for like, where did that come from, man?
That was one of those I literally like fist bumping in the air, like screaming out loud. Like that was a good goal. And from somebody I've been really enjoying his play, like he's really making a good case.
Yeah. Kaprizov with another one, and then you had Nathan MacKinnon and Nichushkin with technically the shorthanded goal because the goalie was pulled and they were on a power play when that happened. So it kind of rounds out the scoring. The Mikko Rantanen one was a little fluky, and if that doesn't sum up what's going on for the Minnesota Wild and their goalie situation right now, I don't know what does. It was a 4-on-4, and MacKinnon just dumps the puck into the zone. And it just, it doesn't go to the side of the goalie, goes right to him. And there wasn't any, it wasn't a hard shot from like center ice. It was a dump in, and the puck just literally just bounces off of him. And Mikko Rantanen is right there to pick it up. Minnesota has got some issues going on in goal. And again, it's another thing where it's like, okay, it's early in the season. You should be able to correct this stuff, but man, when something like that happens, if you're a Wild fan, you just have to throw your hands up and say, like, you know, I always go back to the Truman Show. How does it end? It was not good.
Yeah. And the thing with Mikko getting another tally, like that's 5 points already. Like he's what my favorite thing to do early in the year is he's on pace for 205 points this year. Like Mikko's having another quietly consistent start to the year.
Yep.
So with the absence of Landeskog, like this is what you want to see. So Mikko getting that tally, as fluky as it is, as Minnesota Wildy, go ahead and trademark that as it is. you love to see him just keep it going. And especially you're looking forward to what he could do in Winnipeg and the back-to-back. If he can keep this going while Landy's out, I think we have just an extra little weapon in the pocket.
Yeah, I thought the Sammy G goal was huge.
Yeah,
because the Avs were really getting outworked.
Yeah,
not out hustled, just outworked on the Wild offensive end, and Minnesota was really turning up the heat. They just had the Avalanche kind of on their heels and chasing a little bit, and that's just the flukiness of hockey. The Avs finally get the puck out of the zone, and then it was, you know, a little bit of back and forth, not too much, but Sam just threw it kind of on net. I'm just going to throw this on net, see what happens, and it got through. Another goal by a Wild ineptitude in goal right now. So yeah, when that's happening, when a team is struggling like that, and you have any opportunity, just throw it on net.
Yeah,
because you have no idea of what's going to happen. And that's two goals that they gave up that were completely preventable, and the Avalanche benefited from it. So that I thought that was a huge goal, because Minnesota was really starting to turn up the heat in that first.
And that's the same philosophy Minnesota used: when nothing's working, just throw it on net. And that's when they hit one off a taser and it went in. So, yeah. I mean, something will happen.
Yeah. And then the MacKinnon goal, that was off of a Makar kind of wrist shot from like right inside the blue line, and tipped by MacKinnon. That was right after Goudreau, because was that one? Let me see. The was the McKinnon one that was on a power play, the Nathan McKinnon one, mm-hmm. and the Wild had a breakaway. Goudreau had a really nice, yeah. nice move, and he kind of just he got his body positioning. Once he got past Georgiev, who kind of came out to try to like knock the puck away, he got it past him and got it past the defender, who I can't remember who it was. I haven't seen the play just because we're recording this right after the fact, but got past the defender and Georgiev, and his body was kind of behind the net, and he's just reaching back to try to like flick it in, and the puck just rolls just past his puck or past his stick. That was, you know, as good a goal as you could get without getting one. And then what happens is Avalanche go right back and Makar flicks the puck towards the net and McKinnon knocks it in. So it literally went from the Wild having a goal just inches away to the Avalanche getting a power play goal, another big goal for them.
Yeah. And that's why we're so nitpicky when it comes to like the penalty kill, because if you do everything consistently and at least at a passing grade, as long as you're doing what you're supposed to do, you could capitalize when other teams make mistakes. And that's the example. That's exactly what you want. If teams are trying over and above their skill level and they make a mistake and you're doing exactly what you're capable of, you're going to make them pay every time. And then you don't have to try so hard.
Well, that's always nice. Work smarter, not harder. And the last thing that I wanted to bring up was the Logan O'Connor penalty. I thought was just completely bogus.
Yeah.
Why, you know, the Minnesota Wild bench holds his stick and, you know, he's trying to get it back. So he kind of, you know, gives a nice shove to whoever it was that was holding it, and he gets called. They got a bench minor for it, but O'Connor also got the penalty for roughing. I'm sorry, but if guys on the bench are messing with the guys on the ice, I'm not saying, you know, it just gives the people on the ice free reign to do whatever they want to the people on the bench and just knock them out. This isn't Slapshot here. But there's got to be some leeway there. Like they messed with the guy on the ice. That is inexcusable to me. So to the fact that they went to a commercial, they called a penalty and they went to commercial. I'm like, good that they called it. And then when they came back from commercial, they got Logan O'Connor in the penalty box. And I'm like, are you kidding me? That to me is just such bush league nonsense when a bench wants to get involved in the game and do that crap. And hold someone's stick. And then when that guy retaliates, and it wasn't like O'Connor did anything insanely egregious. He's annoyed. I'd be annoyed too. I shouldn't have to worry about the bench when I'm on the ice. And to give him a penalty that I thought was a little ridiculous.
Especially with how the refs were very picky on what they wanted to call. Even though there were a good amount of penalties and power plays on both sides. I think both teams were
total.
Yeah, I think 50% both sides on the power play.
Yeah.
There was a roughing that should have been called when Manson was thrown to the ice, and they just kind of let that go. And then a lot of after the whistle activity that was not called or intervened, and that they would call that. So it's really sitting on the front of my mind that I forgot the referees play a big part in the season, and we have to keep our eye out for that.
They can. So, but overall, this is a good win for the Avs because, like I said, it's a division game. But I don't know. I liked it. I thought this was a fun game to watch. And sometimes you need a little like wackiness in a hockey. Not everything is going to go smoothly and go, you know, pristine, and everything is going to be like what we're used to in Colorado Avalanche hockey. You're going to get that. You're going to get a lot of that. But every once in a while, you want like these like grind them out a little bit sloppy games. I'm okay with those kind of games.
And it was made just a little bit sweeter with Arizona winning against Toronto. And Minnesota is the only team in the Central who has not tallied a win.
They're the last ones left?
They're
really?
Because Arizona.
In the Central.
Yes, in the Central.
Okay. Wow.
And we were talking about the dumpster fire, the race for the bottom, the tank for Bedard between Arizona and Chicago. And Minnesota is doing it without even trying.
Are you saying Minnesota should throw in the towel and tank for Bedard right now? Yeah.
Get a head start.
Don't see that happening, but hey. All right, let's get to our sound check and our players of the game. If you are new to Locked On Avalanche, our Locked On Avalanche sound check is after every game, win or lose, Kyle and I will select songs we best feel describe the most recent game. And then those songs get added to a playlist over on Spotify. So just search for it, LOA Soundcheck. This is volume number 2. Volume 1 was last year. You can still follow that one, of course. But volume 2 is out and available right now on Spotify. So go follow that. What do you got for this one, Mr. Shaggy Von Doom? Avalanche versus Wild, 6-3 victory for the Colorado Avalanche.
I guess from in this soundcheck, you can call me Petty Von Doom.
Okay.
Just winning a Stanley Cup does not make me hate the Wild less. My sound check for tonight after this wonderful win, Let's Go Crazy from Prince.
Oh, yes. Well, yeah. I mean, that's one you can usually save for, championship or party time or something like that.
A win in Minnesota, it just fits because it's
about
Prince.
Equal. It's about equal footing.
It's Prince.
Stanley Cup victory. Third game of the season win over Minnesota. They're interchangeable. I mean,
that's right.
They're technically the same thing from what I hear.
We beat them in the home of Ben Myers, where Ben Myers became famous.
Who got a goal, like we said.
We're going to take your rock icon as our sound check.
Such a good song, such a good album. And if you want a good cover version of Let's Go Crazy, Incubus.
No way. I didn't know they covered that.
A fantastic cover version of it. So go check that out. For me, I'm going to go with Gogo Bordello, the Gypsy Punks themselves. And the song is Forces of Victory. So I just kind of felt like there's a lot of forces at play in this game. And like I said, that whole like mashup, this game had everything. Yeah. The good, the bad, the ugly, the sloppy. Some like I said, good defensive play. That one play that we were talking about that Minnesota didn't score on the shorthanded goal, pretty play there. And then Avalanche come right back and score, and grabbing the stick on the bench, and just it literally had so much in this game that you can just say like that was good, followed up by something bad. A lot of forces at play here. So, Gogo Bordello, Forces of Victory. To this day, if I don't know if they're touring. If Gogo Bordello comes to your town, appointment concert.
Wow.
It is one of the best shows you will ever see in your life.
Interesting.
If you just want a little bit of a taste, obviously you can go to YouTube and bring up some live stuff. But in person, incredible, incredible performances that they put on.
Wow. Awesome.
Yeah, check them out. All right. And as far as players of the game go, we'll throw out our top three. We'll throw out our top two, and then we'll discuss our number one. So who you got for 3 and 2?
I have Nuke tallying 3 points on the night.
Yeah.
Continuing to keep going. That's my number three. My number two, Sammy G. Good to see you back, my friend.
Yeah.
Former official player of Locked On Avalanche, Sammy G.
That's right.
Yeah. So
who was your number three? Was Nichushkin?
Yep, it was Nichushkin, number three, Sammy G, number two.
I will go when you know what? Man, like, see, I mean, you could throw Nathan MacKinnon here all the time with this. It seems like he's just going to be a nightmare for teams this year. 3 more points for him, a goal and 2 assists. But I'm going to leave him off here just because it's sometimes a little bit too easy just to put him on here. So I'll leave him off for now, but I have to give him, I just got to throw that out there. Maybe he's like the number four, if you want to put honorable mention, if you want to put him out there, but he easily could have been the best player, the number one. But I'm going to put Bo Byram at number three because I thought he's not on the stat sheet as far as no goals, no assists, but over 20 minutes of ice time. But I just thought he was everywhere. He had a couple really good opportunities to score a goal. rubbed Kaprizov right off the puck. And yeah. Kaprizov was coming in hot on the left-hand side. Byram stuck with him, kind of rode him up against the boards, took the puck away from him. So I thought Byram just had a really good, sound game. And this is one of those things where it's like it's not on the stat sheet, but I thought he played a great game.
I agree.
He'd be my number three. And then you know what? I'll stay with the defense for number two, Josh Manson.
Yeah.
Had a goal and played fantastic defense all night long. So even, you know, if he didn't have a goal, I probably still would have put him at number two, and I would have had my number three and number two with 0 points, but just what they did, like non-stat sheet stuff, I thought they played fantastic games. So those would be my three and two. And I have a feeling our number one will be the same, but go for it.
Alexander Georgiev.
Yeah, it's got to be.
Alexander Georgiev.
Got to be. Got to be. Yep. He was great. And we talked about the, you know, like, we when they got him, and I was kind of a little bit upset, I'm like, I wanted a guy who can bail out the Avs sometimes. And this was one game. But he did it on a couple plays. We talked about the Eric Johnson one in particular. So, yeah, I thought he was impressive. And even though 3 goals you give up, you're like, eh, maybe that's not so good. But no, like they were two power play goals. And you're playing against an offensive team. So it's going to be tough to shut them completely down.
He faced 39 shots. A desperate, wild, angry, primal team. Wild, no pun intended. Yeah. Like you faced 39 shots, only let 3 by you. You know the offense is going to bail you out. But the whole team got to see your performance. And now they have this confidence in you, and you have this confidence in them. And this is what you build on going forward into a back-to-back this weekend and next weekend. This is the kind of confidence in the moments that you build, and you start trusting your brand new goalie.
Mm. Yeah, I thought it was a good performance that you can, like you said, you build off of it. So... And I thought the third line looked pretty good tonight too.
Mm-hmm.
I thought JT Confort, who had an assist, I thought he played a very sound game. I did.
Came close to a couple goals.
They came close. Rodriguez had mm-hmm. some, let's see, he had 5 shots on goal, Evan Rodriguez. And, you know, so he's getting some looks. What did, Confort? Yeah. A couple shots on goal. And Cogliano, you know, he had an assist as well, and he's always just a solid player as well. I really liked the third line.
Yeah.
I thought the third line had a really good game. So, you know, from top to bottom, again, it was just all over the place, but you can really pick out some really good things that the Avs did in this game to work on. And that's what you want to do at this stage in the game. Like it's not all going to be sunshine and rainbows. It's going to have some bumps in the road, but the good things that you can pick out of it, you run with those. Goaltending is definitely one of them. I'm talking about the third line right now. That's definitely one of them. I think that they had a really good game, and you just keep building on this stuff. And then before you know it, everybody's in sync.
And the way JT Confort was playing, I feel like he's going to get a goal probably in the Winnipeg game, at least the Seattle game, because he was slapping that stick on the ice, calling for a pass because he feels it. He's right there. Like he's got that confidence and that energy. Like I feel he's about to hit a breakthrough.
Yeah, he was good. I thought he played real well. Which is good because, like, in the Calgary game, he was kind of non-existent. So,
both Chicago and Calgary.
Do you have anything in the Calgary or in the Chicago game? I don't think he had any. Yeah. So, whatever. Turning around. It was good. So, all right, everybody. That's going to wrap it up for today's episode. Like we said, the Avs off today, technically, and Wednesday at home. Back home, friendly confines of Ball Arena against the Winnipeg Jets, who I guess have more wins than the Minnesota Wild right now.
Yeah, right? I think they're sitting technically in third in the Central. It's all goofy. Winnipeg. Don't look at the standings.
No, please. It's nuts right now. So whatever. But all right, that's going to wrap it up. Thank you everybody for tuning in and making it your first listen of the day. Obviously, that is always appreciated. And follow us on all of our social media outlets. And we'll be back tomorrow with a fresh episode. He is Mr. Shaggy Von Doom, Mr. Kyle Sullivan. I am Chris Maselli. This is the Locked On Avalanche podcast. See you guys tomorrow.